So I'd had some discussion with, in particular, Bernard Barrow. He and I became good friends. We talked about the different approaches that we might have had as a result of his coming from the circuit court and my coming from the private bar. Bernard had been in private practice, and in fact, we had tried a case with him down in Norfolk, you know, a desegregation case. He was representing some clients in a peripheral matter in one of those, so I had some knowledge of him before I went on to the court. So I had those kinds of discussions with him. When we got together, we had to create the court really from ground zero. We had some rules of court because the committee that established the court put together a rules committee and they prepared the basic rules of court. But beyond that, there was really nothing there. Some of us did not have offices. Because I was in Richmond and in the Supreme Court building, there were offices prepared for the Court of Appeals. There were four judges' chambers and offices for law clerks. But outside of that, there were no offices in other places. And we pretty much decided that the judges would have offices where they live. One of the commitments that the legislature wanted from the court was that we would hear cases in places other than Richmond. Many of the lawyers in the bar sort of resented having to come to Richmond every time they had an appeal, and they wanted to have some of these appeals in localities outside of Richmond. So we agreed that the judges would have offices where they live, and so they had to set them. They had to set up these offices. So there were all these logistical problems of putting the court together, and almost immediately we had appeals that were filed. So we had to establish our internal operating procedures, how we were going to do very mundane, routine kinds of things. So it was a very interesting but busy early period.
How long did it take before you all were set up to handle your first set of cases?
I think when we began on January 1, I believe that there were several appeals that had already been filed. So they were waiting for us. We were really moving toward getting that done. There were two judges here in the Richmond office. I was here, and Ballard Baker, who was our first chief judge. We elected Ballard to be our first chief judge, and he died very quickly after the court was established. And so right away, we had to have another judge. The legislature had to add another judge, and we had to deal with that change. You know, the chief judge was gone, electing another chief judge, starting another chief judge from ground zero. So it was a very busy time. I think we maybe heard an appeal within a month or two of starting.
Do you remember your first case or cases?
I remember, yes, I think the first case I sat on with Ballard Baker and one other judge, and it was a workers' compensation case. I couldn't tell you the name of it at this point. That was the first one. And Ballard wrote the opinion but died before it was issued. You know, so it was a very, very hectic time, very interesting time.
What kind of adjustments did you go through in going from the lawyer side to now an appeals judge?
Mm-hmm. I think the biggest was being away from people. As a lawyer, you're constantly around other people, other lawyers, clients, you know, people in your law office. There's this daily pace, you know, sometimes very hectic, but you're always surrounded by people. When I began this job, it was less hectic in the sense that I wasn't being tugged at from here to there by clients and judges and all the demands of practice. On the other hand, initially, of course, it was the idea of putting this thing together and being part of a group to put this together. Dealing with the dynamic of a multi-judge court. Unlike the trial courts where the judge sits and hears cases and the jury is there, but the judge, he or she, is ultimately making his or her own rulings, on a multi-judge court, you have two other judges at a minimum that are trying to reach a collective decision. So there's this group dynamic process that I think to me was a bit different than, you know, than my previous experience. As I said, I think one of the great benefits for me was that I had had federal appellate experience. And while it was as a lawyer, I had a real sense of the dynamic of an appeals court.
Do you recall when you first wrote the majority opinion?
First majority opinion? Well, I think it was within that first 6 months.
Was there an adjustment in how you were approaching writing an opinion versus writing a brief?
Yes, yes.
What did you go through?
Well, I mean, in writing a brief, obviously you are an advocate for a position, and while trying to reconcile the legal precedent out there, you're still always an advocate. In writing the opinion, you're trying to reconcile the precedent. To reach a conclusion, but also you're not any longer an advocate for either side. The big, for me, I think the big task was to get the facts right. You know, we're bound by these rules of appellate procedure. So that we always have to look at the facts in the light most favorable to the party that prevailed below. Having said that, there still are certain ways that we have to deal with the facts. And to me, that was always the critical thing, because as a lawyer, you know, I always thought that some legal issues were debatable, but facts were the facts. And I always felt that that was important to get the facts right. And so whenever we had lawyers before us as advocates, they would often fudge, is a bad word, but I can't think of a better word right at the moment, fudge some of the facts to fit their cases. And for me as a judge, that was the one thing I always tried to do, is to be sure that we got the facts right.
In looking at the caseload and the and some of the decisions,
mm-hmm.
that you wrote, there were a number of times when you concurred
mm-hmm.
on some issues,
yes.
and didn't concur on other issues, and you wrote a separate opinion explaining that. I was curious about why you found yourself in disagreement in that particular way, not just disagreeing wholeheartedly, but almost a split kind of decision that was being made. And I was wondering, what really brought, how did you arrive at those kinds of positions?
Yes. I think one of the guiding principles that appellate judges work with is that unanimity is important. It's always important because when the law is clear, people are really able to judge their conduct. On the other hand, when there are what I call legitimate disagreements about, for example, what the facts are, or what the guiding principles are, my view always was that part of my obligation as a judge was to be true to what I believe the facts that control the case were, and to be true to the application of the guiding principles to those facts. And I felt that when I had a legitimate disagreement about those, that it was important to state that. Not only because it was important to the litigants, but so many of our cases were cases that could be appealed to the Supreme Court, and it would be important for the Supreme Court to see that there was, if I believe that to be the case, a way of stating the facts or the relevant law that was contrary to what was in the majority opinion, then I needed to do that. So there were times when I wrote concurring opinions. There were times when I wrote dissents. I was on the court for 24 years. I suspect that during that time I probably wrote more dissents than any of my colleagues.
Why do you think that was the case?
In some ways, I think it was because I had a different feel for some of the principles, some of the constitutional principles, particularly in criminal cases.
Explain what you mean.
Well, I believe that the constitutional rights, the Bill of Rights, are very important, and I felt that when those issues came before us, that I should look at them very closely. And when I disagreed with my colleagues about those, I felt it was important to stress that, and I did. I wasn't hesitant in doing that.
Were you perhaps one of the only justices on that court who came from a civil rights advocacy background as opposed to perhaps more corporate law or
as a general rule, I think that was correct. As I said, I recall my friend Bernard Barrow had a case in which he represented some clients in civil rights matter. One of the other judges on the court had represented some corporate clients in civil rights litigation, defending them. But by and large, yes. I mean, I spent much of my career litigating cases of people who had been outside the system and who had sought to vindicate, you know, their constitutional rights. And so, yes, that's always been important to me. And you know, it's in the last several years, there have been a number of cases in which people have been exonerated because of DNA test results. People who were wrongfully convicted, we now know that. But you know, at the time that these cases were going through the courts, in many of those cases, you know, people raised the question of the sufficiency of the evidence to prove that they did what they did. And for various reasons, those defenses were overlooked and they were convicted. I've always believed that when the question of the sufficiency of the evidence to convict someone of a crime, that those cases require a very discerning eye. Liberty is very precious. And every time I saw one of those cases where someone spent 10 or 17 years in prison for something that he did not do, I find that very chilling. Because you know, you ask someone, you go to someone in the street and say, "I want to put you in prison for 17 years. How much do you want for that? How much can I pay you for that?" There are very few people who would accept any amount of money to suffer that experience. So it's in those criminal cases that I just felt that it was very important to look at those cases to be sure that when the Constitution requires that proof be beyond a reasonable doubt, and we were charged with looking at the sufficiency of the evidence to establish those cases, that we looked at those cases very carefully. And yes, in a number of cases, you know, my colleagues and I had a disagreement about whether the standard of proof had been met. And when that happened, I felt I needed to write, and I did.
Did the court have clerks working along with each of the justices?
Judges,
I'm
yes.
sorry,
We
judges.
were all judges.
Yeah.
I always have to tell the lawyers that, you know, they call us justices, and I said, "Don't elevate me, or at least if you elevate me, give me the pay." We were all judges and Supreme Court justices or justices. Yes, we started with 10 judges, and each judge had one law clerk. The legislature, at some point, I think in the 90s, made a political decision to add another judge. We had 11, and they also added another law clerk. So when I left the court, the judges had two law clerks.
Now, you said for political reasons they expanded it to 11. Explain.
Well, I mean, I was not a legislator, I was not a politician. I always stayed out of the political fights. But they added another judge. I think it was a political compromise decision call.
Did that have something to do with representation around the state, or were there other reasons?
As far as I know, it had nothing with representation around the state. I'm not sure of the political reasons.
How did you choose your law clerks?
Oh my. that was one of the interesting parts of my job. I got each year lots of applications for them, sometimes 40 or more.
Were they mostly from one law school or just
They
from?
were from everywhere. I mean, I got them from pretty much most of the law schools in the state, but also from North Carolina, California. Law students look for clerkships. It's a good thing, I suppose, to have not only on your resume, but I think the experience is a good experience for a recent graduate of the law school. So I got plenty of applications. And I try to weed them out or narrow them to maybe five that I consider to be worth interviewing. And
did you have an assistant working along with you to weed them out?
I didn't really designate that to anyone. I looked at each one of them. I would decide which of the group I might want to select. I would select about five of them, looking at their grades, what they took in law school. They submitted writing samples. I would look at the writing sample. I looked at what they did in life, what experiences that they had.
What were some of the things that you were interested that they had or that they brought with them to the table?
Well, there are a variety of things. Some of them were well-traveled, you know, who had lived in other countries. Some had been teachers. Some had worked for Peace Corps. I was looking for people who had a wide range of experiences, people who had interest in things sometimes not of the law. And so I would look at those, select maybe five people, and then I would interview them, talk to them.
Did you have any law clerks who shared your passion for civil rights?
I think on occasion I had some who had that experience that I looked at as being significant. On occasion, I would run across that. You know, I think one of my clerks spoke four languages. I thought that was quite impressive. You know, had lived in some other countries, did well in law school. I didn't look for or require my clerks to believe what I believed. To me, that was not important to me. And it wasn't important to me because ultimately I felt that the final decision was mine. I wanted people who I thought could think. And so I think ultimately that's what I was sort of looking for, people who had done other things, been exposed to other events, and who I thought had the ability to analyze and think.
When you sat down to write a decision, what kinds of things or what was your approach to writing those decisions?
Oh my.
And I'm thinking not just philosophically, but also
yes,
just the fundamentals.
Well, as I said, the first thing I was concerned about was what are the facts? And bearing in mind that we didn't have the privilege of starting from ground zero and saying, okay, this is what they testified to, this is what I believe. We are constrained by certain principles, that is, that basically where there's a dispute at trial, the person who prevails gets the benefit of the doubt. That's put simply, but that's basically the principle. And so within those confines, I wanted to be sure that we got the facts right. And once I was satisfied with that, then it seemed to me that I then had to deal with the conflicting legal principles and how they impacted on those facts. But as I said, to me, critically, the first thing was always to get the facts. So when I was with my clerks, talking to my clerks, that was one of the things we always tested out was, okay, you know, is this legitimate? And could the inference, what are the legitimate inferences that could be drawn from these facts? So I would talk with my clerks about that all the time. Very important, because it was often there that where there might have been a disagreement between me and my colleagues, that might have been the area where there was a real problem. Yeah. What the trial judge or the trier of fact could have legitimately inferred from those facts. So if there was a critical issue, that was it for me. Because by and large, I think the lawyers did a fairly decent job of laying out the guiding legal principles.
When you actually wrote your decisions, did you write it out longhand?
I did, and part of that was just because of when I came onto this earth, there were no computers around, and I tend to think while part of my thinking process is wrapped up in writing, and I'm not a great typist, and when I'm typing, I'm thinking more about typing than I am about my thought process. So yeah, I wrote longhand.
And who would you trust to then transcribe it? Your secretary?
Yeah, I have a wonderful secretary. And she was with me at my law firm and came with me to this job.
Oh.
And so she could read my handwriting, and she did that for me.
Were there any cases that you had to hear that were particularly challenging for you? And by challenging, I mean, here you are looking at the rule of law,
mm-hmm.
and then you're looking at the facts of the case,
mm-hmm.
and you're not a lawyer,
mm-hmm.
you're a judge.
Mm-hmm.
So were there any cases that seemed to create conflict for you?
Mm-hmm. I can think, for example, I talked to you earlier about DNA, and the question of DNA. One of the big unresolved issues, and in some cases improperly resolved issues, I think, has been this whole question of eyewitness identification. People have difficulty identifying people, particularly across racial lines. We've been a very segregated society. We still are in many ways. We don't know people across races and cultures. And it's very difficult for people to make those kinds of identifications. One of the things that, and of course we are bound by our Supreme Court precedents, one of the things that I think they really have maybe not gotten right is the whole question of whether a defendant or a litigant can establish the difficulty of cross-racial identifications, so that when the trier of fact is trying to determine whether a person may have misidentified someone, they can put on expert testimony to establish that there are difficulties here with these kinds of identifications and identification procedures. That's one of the areas that I just had a lot of difficulty with, because I don't think that we in Virginia have approached that in the right way. And, I'm constrained by the decisions of my Supreme Court. I was constrained by the decision of my Supreme Court in reaching that kind of issue in most cases. And there are others, most of them in the area of criminal law, whether the police have to videotape an interrogation, when the interrogation is made in the police station. I always thought that that was something important to require, but...
Why?
Because I think that it's very significant what one puts on the videotape, as opposed to having you later transcribe and say, this is what he said, or to simply testify that I spoke to this person for an hour, and during that period of time, this is what he said. To me, the more persuasive evidence of that would be the videotape itself. And you know, when the police are in their station and they have the ability to do that, I always thought that it's fairly significant that they be required to do that. Again, you know, there are certain areas where we just haven't gotten there. I'm constrained by state law, you know, to rule on those issues. So there were areas where I felt some discomfort with having to rule on those cases in the absence of what I considered to be good precedent to deal with.
Few more questions.
Yes.
And these have to do with personal decisions that you've made, and a little bit more about your personal life and background. We talked a mm-hmm. little bit about that early on with your parents and so forth.
Yes.
You made a decision to retire from the court in 2007.
Yes.
Why?
Oh, I've been in the court for 24 years. I felt it was just time to go. You know, I had done, I think, as much as I could do there. And I just personally felt it was time to get away. And I did. I'm not sure I have a better answer for you than that. You know, I practiced for 15 years. I've been a judge for 24 years. There are other good people out there. It was time to go.
Did you have any objectives, or not objectives, but aspirations to do other things?
Yes. I mean, one of the things that I wanted to do was to just simply take off for a while, not do any law. For all the years that I practiced law and been a judge, most of my friends were non-lawyers. I have a lot of friends in other countries, and I wanted to travel, and we have traveled. So that was a big goal of mine, simply to get out and travel and see some different places. And I'm going to do some volunteer work. I've done a little, but I'll do more later. But there are places I want to go that won't let me commit long-term to some things that I intend to do shortly.
And what are some of those things you intend to do shortly?
Most of them are non-legal. I want to do some stuff with teenagers.
Urban teenagers?
Yes, yes,
okay.
Yes.
And this will be through foundations or through other organizations?
In my community.
Okay. On the personal side mm-hmm. of your life, you talked about going to college, graduate school, then law school. During that period, did you get married?
Yes.
So tell us a little bit about who you married and when.
I married in the summer before I went to law school, a woman who I had gone to high school with, and we were married until 1990, divorced, and I remarried in 93, and I've been happily married since then.
So tell me the name of your first wife, the name of your second wife, and whether you had any children.
Yes. My first wife was Faye Young, and we had one daughter. Her name is Laverne. Laverne is now 36. She has a 10-year-old who is 10 years old on Sunday, Aisha. My present wife is Marianne Ruckman, and she was a teacher, a history, high school history teacher. She retired also several years ago. She has two daughters, Lisa and Laura, and Lisa has three daughters, Kaylee, Kristen, and Laura. And Laura has one daughter, Alden. So we have three daughters and five granddaughters. Wonderful kids. Who we travel with from time to time. We take our granddaughters with us every year. We take either two or three away. So the last trip was, we took three of our granddaughters to Germany at Christmas time.
So did any of your daughters follow in your footsteps?
No. My daughter Laverne is a banker. Marianne's daughters are, one's a chemist and one is a real estate technical person. Yeah, no lawyers there. And I don't see the granddaughters becoming lawyers either. But then again, you know, I didn't start out wanting to be a lawyer when I was young.
I was wondering, looking back over your 15 years as an attorney and your 24 years as a judge, what do you regret the most, and what do you applaud the most about your experiences?
Okay. Let me start with the last one first, applaud. Maybe if this doesn't answer applaud, maybe tell me what you're talking about. One of my great experiences was working with Oliver Hill and Sam Tucker. Two extraordinary lawyers. Mr. Hill was one of the lawyers in Brown versus Board of Education. Spent pretty much most of his adult lawyer life trying civil rights cases, believing that human rights were something that we should all strive for and develop. As I said, he was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the highest civil award that any civilian can receive in this country. Sam Tucker was an extraordinary man. He was a genius. Sam Tucker studied law. He never went to law school, and he passed the bar exam early, so that he was not able to practice law at the time. He was too young to practice law when he passed the bar exam. When Sam was young, in the 40s, he sat in at the Alexandria library to desegregate the library. Couldn't go into the library and sit anywhere that he wanted. And Sam was an extraordinary lawyer. Lawyers from all around, African-American lawyers from all around the state would come to our office and sit with Sam Tucker and thrash out their legal theories on tough cases. And Sam would talk to them and help them come to some understanding of those issues and maybe help them rewrite their briefs. And I had the privilege for 15 years to work with both of those men. And that to me was the highest part of my career. I learned so much from them. The only downside to that experience was that neither one of them, that they grew up at a time when they couldn't do what I did, and that is to become a judge, because I think that both of them would have been extraordinary as judges. Downside, I don't know. I mean, that's very difficult. I've had two great jobs. You know, I go to high schools and I talk to students about careers and things. I tell them I've had two great jobs. Every morning, I was ready to get up and go to work. I liked what I did. And so I don't know that I can, I'm sure there's something, but I don't know that there's some downside to what I did. I would like to have been able to convince some more of my colleagues on occasion about a case here or there. If there's a downside in my life, it probably was in segregated Norfolk, Virginia, in the 50s.
Thank you so much.
Well, you're welcome.